Thank you very much, Dr. Conway, for your gracious introduction. And thank you very much to the Sansum Clinic and College Hospital for this invitation to come. Invitation that you have heard started in 2019. And I was very excited to come. No, I'm really serious. I was very excited because you cannot really go around the country and mention Santa Barbara without immediately in our surgical circles, immediately recognizing this beautiful visiting professorship and this beautiful opportunity to exchange ideas and cross-pollinate. And I'd like to thank Dr. Latimer for having started this 10 years ago plus. This is a great idea, and one idea that probably I'm gonna steal back in New York one way or the other. I've had the great opportunity to be the longest professor in waiting. I think I should have an asterisk on that wall. Because 2019, I was so excited, and as you have heard, we had planned it for March 20th of 2020, and I was really busy with other things at that time. And then we decided to do it, to try for 2021, because we all thought that this COVID pandemic was going to be probably 3 or 4 months, and then we're going to be back to our normal life. And in 2021, we were in the midst of another wave in New York City, and so 2022, and now it's 2023. And I'm pleased to be here, and I think we should all be pleased to be here in consideration of the ravages that COVID has brought on this country and in the world in general, and the personal losses that we all have either experienced or heard about. So, I'd like also to thank all of you for coming here. First of all, I recognize surgical colleagues. I recognize the spouses of surgical colleagues. I recognize, obviously, physicians from Sansum Clinic and from College Hospital. I recognize the trustees. It is a pleasure to really talk to all of you. And I don't have too many slides. I really would like to have this more of a conversation than a talk, certainly not a lecture. I'll have some slides and I'll go through them, but potentially there will be some more conversation and at the end of these slides. So I'll need to have some disclosure. They have nothing to do with COVID. I'm on the Scientific Advisory Board of Tsumura. It's a Japanese pharmaceutical company. They're developing a new prokinetic drug to facilitate motility of the intestine, especially after surgery. And I'm on the Scientific Advisory Board of Verily. But I can tell you and I can swear they have nothing to do with COVID. So they're disclosures, but there are no conflicts. This is a very telling slide. We didn't have a wave, we had a tsunami. And I still remember March 7th, when we had the first patient admitted to New York Presbyterian Hospital. Now I have three Cornelians here in this room. They've introduced themselves, and thank you very much for coming. And they knew that place as New York Hospital. New York Hospital, a very famous hospital, and even infamous hospital, because many things have started in good and bad from New York Hospital. New York Hospital changed its name to New York Presbyterian Hospital in 1996, when Dr. Skinner, the then president of New York Hospital and a surgeon himself, actually a thoracic surgeon who had recruited me at the University of Chicago. And let me just take this as a small deviation from the talk. I was a young pup. I was finishing my residency. I was looking for an academic job, and I really wanted to become an academic surgeon. I was offered to stay at NYU. Dr. Cameron, the first Sansum visiting professor here, had offered me a job at Hopkins. I go to the University of Chicago where Dr. Skinner was the chair of the Department of Surgery, and I'm really impressed by this towering figure and by this academic surgeon. And I'm ready to sign on. But, you know, I just want to make sure that this gentleman, this chair, is there to coach me for a long time. He had been chair already for 12 years. So I asked him, Dr. Skinner, how long are you planning to be here as chair? And without missing a beat, he said, for a very long time. And he said, I still remember it now, he said, because I know exactly, I was a resident at the MGH, Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston. I was a faculty member at Hopkins. And in both cases, I've witnessed chairs of surgery staying in position for 30 years. He had been only for 12 years. I make my calculation. It's going to be at least another 18. Because it takes 30 years to create the next cadre of academic surgeons. I signed immediately, and 3 years later, he goes to New York. And he becomes the president of New York Hospital. He goes there, and it is practically if 1 year or two after the death of Warhol, Andy Warhol, at New York Hospital. And after other problems. And New York Hospital in 1987 was losing $50 million a year. Now, you know what that means. $50 million a year is a lot of money, especially in 1987. And he used to come around and go with his wife, Ellie, to a dinner. And an hour into the dinner, he would say to his wife, Ellie, we got to go home. I got to go back to work. I already lost $100,000. So, but nevertheless, New York Hospital became New York Presbyterian Hospital because Dr. Skinner organized a merger with a Presbyterian Hospital on the Upper West Side. New York Hospital is connected to Weill Cornell, at that time was Cornell Medical School. And the Presbyterian Hospital on the Upper West Side connected to Columbia. But the hospitals merged. And merged under his leadership, and they took the name of New York Presbyterian Hospital. Now, this is a large system nowadays. It's 10 different sites. Obviously, the two flagships are the old New York Hospital and Milstein Hospital at Columbia. But there are also two other hospitals, one in Brooklyn, one in Queens, equally large. If you take all the 10 hospitals, there are 3,600 beds. So it's a major health system. And there are 400 ICU beds. So many that some hospitals in the United States don't even have 400 regular beds. And we care for 1 out of 4 New Yorkers. So this is a big system. March 7 arrives. First patient with COVID arrives. And that's what happened. And the peak of that wave in blue up there, I said I wouldn't need the pointer, but I do. This is the peak. This was April 23rd. 6 weeks. 6 weeks where you knew that the following day was going to be worse than the previous day. And we went from one patient to 2,600 patients out of 3,600 beds. And you can see there, every single hospital of our 10 hospitals was hit by this tsunami. and the four major hospitals at Columbia, Cornell, Brooklyn, and Queens got really pummeled down by this. So that was the wave. And as I said, we didn't know whether we would survive. We didn't know we would survive as a system. We didn't know whether we would survive as individuals. We kept an eye on what happened in Italy, in the Milano region, because they were ahead of 4 or 5 weeks. And the epicenter there was Bergamo. And you may have been to Bergamo, you may not have been to Bergamo, but I'm sure you have drunk San Pellegrino water. It comes from Bergamo. So that was the epicenter. So we knew that it was going to get worse, much worse. And we started losing colleagues. In my department, we lost a breast surgeon. At Columbia, a very good liver transplant surgeon, Dr. Cato, ended up in the ICU for weeks. And he was practically dead. He went even on ECMO. And if you know what ECMO means, only 1 out of 10 makes it alive through ECMO. He was discharged months later, and he was really a shadow of himself. But at least he made it home. We also ran out of everything. We ran out of supplies, gloves, masks, PPEs. We ran out of equipment. We did not have enough ventilators. It's not an easy situation to be as a physician. When you don't have enough ventilators. So we went into the basement to find ventilators that had not been used in 20 years. We experiment in using one ventilator for 2 patients. Not easy. Not easy at all. And occasionally on the news, or in the newspapers, you could see a cargo of masks coming from China. 1 million masks arrived to New York City. Do you want to know how many masks we used every day? 55,000. So 1 million masks. They keep you alive for 15 days. And forget about gloves, forget about gowns, forget about protecting yourself. So what we learned? That we need stockpiling. And now we have this large storehouses where we have the most common things, IV poles, ventilators, gloves, masks, PPEs, because we don't know when, but we're pretty sure there will be another epidemic, another pandemic in the future, and we need to be prepared. But we ran out of ICUs. 400 ICUs. As I said before, more than what some hospitals have in regular beds. So, first thing that went were the operating rooms. An operating room is a great ICU. And we put two patients per operating room. Once the operating rooms are occupied by patients, you cannot do surgery. So, for instance, we left five operating rooms open for traumas, which fortunately declined. All bars were closed and nobody was out. Trauma declined. Somehow even appendicitis declined, but occasionally you had an appendicitis. And then you had advanced cancers that needed to be dealt with. But let me tell you, and we'll revisit this concept later on, this was not life as usual. And so we really had to figure out how to use our resources and make difficult decisions. When the ORs were all full, we went into the recovery rooms, which are already equipped with monitors, with IV poles, with nurses. And then we ran out of recovery rooms as well. And we started open ICUs in places that you wouldn't even know about. Regular floors became ICUs. From 400 ICU beds in the system, we ended up needing 920 ICUs. What we learned from this? That we're now building new floors and new wards with flexible capabilities. Because it is not just the space that you need for an ICU. It is not just a monitor. It is not just an IV pole. You also need gases there. You also need a larger electrical grid to keep everything going. So we need to build, we need to be smart and build floors that can be changed overnight into ICUs. And that's what we have learned from this tragedy. But we learned also ran out of manpower. Because not all of us can take care of this severely, critically ill patients. We didn't have enough intensivists. We didn't have enough physicians in the ICUs. And we certainly didn't have enough physicians in the new ICUs. Fortunately, we have a great culture in our system, a culture for which all can and should contribute. And so as you can see there, 300 physicians and physicians were redeployed. Redeployed from their normal life to a totally new life and a new situation. In the Department of Surgery, we start categorizing our faculty. Obviously, we have intensivists, and they knew where they need to be in the surgical ICU. And in the burn ICU, which was converted into another surgical ICU. They stayed doing their job, but they had a workload, a patient load, which was much bigger than the usual one. Then we had individuals that were deployed in our department, such as general surgeons for acute care surgery and trauma, vascular surgeons for line teams to put lines in these patients with COVID. They were deployed within our own departments. And surgeons that hadn't done trauma in some time, well, they were deployed to take care of trauma because the intensivists, who are also in general the trauma surgeons, they're also too busy taking care of the COVID patients. And then there were some of us deployed to other areas of the hospital in need of manpower, emergency room. Emergency room needed that desperately, support. So some of my faculty members went down and became ED physicians. Hospital medicine, telemedicine. We did not want to have patients come into the hospital unnecessarily. So we created a system of telemedicine to reach out to them and for them to reach out to us. And so, you know, if you are, say, I don't want to pick on any of our colleagues, but if you're a breast surgeon who may feel uncomfortable in an ICU because of the difficulty and the complexity of the care, well, you know what? You can do telemedicine. You can at least reassure, you can at least triage, you can at least guide patients whether they can stay at home or have alternative ways of taking care of their problems or come to the hospital. I want to point out to you this lady here on the left side, your left side. She's Dr. Lisa Newman. She's a professor of surgery, and she's the chief of breast surgical oncology in our institution. She came to me, and this really speaks to the culture of our place. She came to me and said, look, Fabrizio, I can't. The last time I was in an ICU was 35 years ago. Honestly, I don't feel particularly up to date in taking care of patients, but I want to contribute. I want to contribute. What can I do? So together, we created a role for her and for a burn surgeon who had just retired 9 months earlier, who again called and said, I know I'm retired, but I want to contribute. What am I going to do at home? You remember that at those times, patient visitations were forbidden. Hospitals were closed. So you had these critically ill patients in the ICUs with a high mortality and no ability for their families to see them and no ability for them to see their family members. Tragic. So, Dr. Newman and Dr. Bessie, every single day, 7 days a week, they made rounds with the ICU team. They took notes. And then they spent the entire afternoon and evening reaching out to the families. All of them. Sometimes with the bad news. So you can imagine what toll they carried for many weeks. But that's a reflection of our culture. So what we learned. We learned that you need to create apical triangular teams where you have the intensivist up there, but then a layer of physicians and residents and nurses, more and more. They can do other things. They may not be good at figuring out the PEEP on respirator, but they can certainly be there turning the patients doing something, communicating with the family, you name it. And that's what we did. Because we couldn't multiply the intensivist, but we certainly redeployed our own workforce. As I said, during those probably 12 weeks until June 23rd, we ran on in our hospital on 5 operating rooms. Some of them for trauma, some of them for trachs, for COVID patients, you name it. Although we learn how to do the trachs at the bedside, even in these critical patients. And so there was a decision of what to operate and what not to operate. How we are rationalizing the resources. Some patients didn't come to the hospital. They were too afraid of coming to the hospital, afraid of catching COVID and dying. I think that many patients died at home of myocardial infarcts because they didn't want to come to the hospital. Some patients didn't come even with a condition that needed to be taken care of. But when they came, we needed to decide whether we had resources to take care of them. And we did, but certainly not as expeditiously as we do on a day-to-day basis. And so I am sure that during those 3 months, and maybe even later, I don't know, there's been some delay in care. And I don't know what the effects will be. It will probably take 5 to 10 years to figure out whether there has been a negative effect, say, on cancer patients. We'll have to see. And the training of our residents really got a major beating. Look at the surgeons. Surgeons become surgeons by operating. And here there was zero operations, practically for 3 months plus. No exposure to surgical conditions, to medical condition means no training. No surgical operations means no surgeons. So what will be the effect of this, to me, is unknown. Although we compensated with simulation facilities. And I think the simulation, which is already essential in a department of surgery and medicine in a hospital, etc., became extremely necessary in this particular situation because we moved our training to the simulation laboratory. It's true, you cannot simulate everything, but at least use that time in learning something, how to put a chest tube, how to do something that you, how to get familiar with the robotic techniques, etc., etc., etc. And this is what we did, and this is also other professional societies did, American College of Surgeons, the Association of Medical Educators promulgated guidelines for teaching during a crisis, during a pandemic. Telehealth. This is Dr. Rasha Simmons, yet another breast surgeon. She was deployed to do telehealth. 8 hours a day, 5 days a week. And that's what she did. Because our medical offices were all closed. And so we needed to stay in touch with patients. We needed also to, as I said before, triage the calls that are coming in from patients. And we provided scripts to all of them on how to triage and figuring out whether it was really necessary to come to the emergency room or not. And that's what she did for many, many, many weeks. And what we have learned? Well, we have learned that, telehealth is great. I love telehealth. Actually, I was doing telehealth even before COVID. But now, 20% of our business is on telehealth. For surgeons, return patients, fortunately, the majority of our patients that do well postoperatively, you can really look at them in the face through telehealth, talk to them, ask them questions, and you know that they don't need to come back to your office, especially if you have closed the incisions without staples, without stitches that need to be removed. And they are happier. Think about New York City. Think about a patient of mine coming down from Connecticut or coming from New Jersey. Okay? They need to take the car. They need to drive for an hour and a half. They fight the traffic in New York City, park. It's going to cost them $40 for 2-3 hours. Go back. They waste the whole day for what? A handshake. Are you doing really well? Thank you. Congratulations. Goodbye. Okay. It's a expensive handshake. But, you know, sometimes even new patients they like to, especially if you have a clientele that comes from a long distance, they like to have a first interview with you and say, this is what I've done. This is the workup. I've been advised to undergo surgery. What do you think? And at that point, what do you think? Okay, well, I think you should. All right, next step is coming to clinic. But sometimes next step is, no, I don't think you need surgery. Let me refer you to a gastroenterologist. So we have learned a lot that telehealth, I think, will stay with us for a long time. And I love it because, you know, I can somehow in telehealth, I'm using 50% of the time. And I'm not shortchanging anyone. And they have the questions and they have the family there, etc. But a return visit that would take me probably 25 minutes in the office because you shake hands, are you doing that? Boom, 15 minutes is done. And everybody's happy. And I get great satisfaction press gainings. Well, something else has happened with COVID. Many people, we told, go home and stay home. All the secretaries, the revenue cycle people, except the administrators, they're all home. And now, you know, I'm not sure they want to come back 5 days a week and fight the traffic in New York City. And so we have moved to a more flexible hybrid way of working. Now, of course, surgeons need to come every day. There's no way out unless you retire. Let me know. But the secretary, my secretary, and she's a good secretary for me, she comes 4 days a week. She takes Friday off. My patient coordinator, she comes 3 days and she works 2 days from home and she feels all the patients call from home and it's no problem. So we moved into a remote work, which obviously is not the same across all health providers, it's not the same across all segments of healthcare, but it has influences. And now, believe it or not, we have much more real estate than we need. So we have to repurpose our real estate because all these offices are not occupied every day. And so that's an opportunity to for the future. Well, this is another painful slide. Because you remember, every night, I'm sure it happened also in Santa Barbara, but certainly in New York at 7 p.m., everybody was clapping. All these physicians, heroes. All these nurses are heroes. But then we start losing colleagues. We start losing nurses. So these heroes were dying. And then we had multiple waves. In New York City, we had 6 waves. The first was the most terrible. But the second and third, is like, you know, after you've run 10 miles, if I tell you to run another 2, I can do it, but maybe not that well. The last 3 waves, much better. Once we had the vaccinations, the number of COVID patients, infections was high, but the number of patients coming into the hospital was not that high. And most of them survived. Prior to vaccination, it was a flip of a coin. Eventually, nurses, residents, physicians, had signs of burnout. It was obvious. And 2 things happened. A wave of suicides that we don't know much about. But Carol Bream was an emergency room physician at Columbia. And she went back home visiting the parents. So she wasn't even in the midst of the COVID wave, and she committed suicide. And then was a great resignation. Nurses had it. How long can you carry that burden? And they had it. And a year ago, our system had a 17% vacancy rate among nurses. We usually run 3%, 17%. 17% is very high, as you can imagine, which made it difficult to care for patients. And now finally we are back to about 6%. But it's not just a question of numbers. You have lost the experienced nurses and you have replaced them with novices out of nursing school. And so things are still tough. It's like the economy. We haven't recovered yet. And it will take some time. I should mention that we have seen, back when I told you that we were running out of staff and physicians, I've seen personally incredible acts of generosity. I mentioned the chief of breast surgery and the retired burn surgeon. We had past chief residents calling us and coming back. One came back for 2 weeks from Irvine, California. One came back for 3 months, and others. Amazing. And they just wanted to come back and give a hand. And they did a fantastic job. Without all this help, we would have not survived. And we also learned something else. And I think we relearned something else. The power of leadership. These are tough times. You don't know how it's going to end up. But you need to be present and reassuring. I made rounds every day in the ICUs. I was not an intensivist. Just asking, what can I do for you? And once a week on Monday, I would send a general email with usually an uplifting message or an uplifting video, whether it was Pavarotti singing Nessun Dorma, or whether it was the, you remember that movie of the Italian jets coming through, to tell them we'll make it. We'll make it together. And you need to be inspiring, supportive, reassuring, because in the end, you need to unify, motivate, and encourage. And leadership is during COVID, is during the Spanish flu, is during a catastrophe. Leadership, you learn this again and again. And it's served us well in the end. And this is where I work. And it's still standing. We're still open. The doors are still open. We're still recovering, but it is, we are well on our way to recover. Thank you very much for allowing me to give this first talk on COVID to all of you. Thank you.